Okay, sorry about that. It was some technical difficulties. We can continue. So, Mr. Hantovolo, a 48-year-old farmer, is a polygamist, married with three wives and 10 children. He is admitted to a male medical ward with the diagnosis of glomerulonephritis. And question one is saying, define glomerulonephritis. So we can define glomerulonephritis as this is a renal disorder in which there is inflammation of the glomerular capillaries resulting into impaired renal function and is characterized by proteinuria, hematuria, and periorbital edema. So when it comes to glomerulonephritis, you need to, whenever you're defining any condition, you need to tell us where this condition is coming from. So we are saying this condition is coming from the renal system. That's why we have mentioned this is a renal disorder. And in this condition, which is coming from the renal system, there is inflammation of the glomerular capillaries. So the actual structure that is affected in the renal system is the glomerulus and the capillaries. So this is going to result into impaired renal function, okay? Okay, so let me just repeat the definition for those who didn't get the definition. So I'm saying we can define glomerulonephritis. So I'm saying we can define glomerulonephritis as this is a renal disorder in which there is inflammation of the glomerular capillaries resulting into impaired renal function characterized by proteinuria, hematuria, and periorbital edema. So this is a renal disorder in which there is inflammation of the glomerular capillaries resulting into impaired renal function and is characterized by proteinuria, hematuria, and periorbital edema. So in glomerulonephritis, I was saying the system it is affecting is the renal system and the structure being affected is the glomerulus. And here, the glomerular capillaries are inflamed, meaning they cannot filter the blood according to what they are supposed to do. Then apart from that, this condition impairs renal function, meaning the renal system is supposed to filter toxins, blood, and excrete other waste products out of the body. But because the renal system is not functioning properly, meaning it impairs its capability. And the characteristic is that you're going to see proteins in urine due to impaired filtration rate of or impaired glomerular filtration. Apart from that, blood will also be seen in urine. Whenever there is an inflammation, substances such as proteins and blood, they are too large to pass through the capillaries. But in inflammation, they pass through the capillary because it is inflamed, and the fenestrated blood vessels becomes too large and allow large blood vessels to even pass through the capillaries and be excreted. That's why you're going to see blood in urine. Apart from that, there will be periorbital edema. So when it comes to periorbital edema, this is mostly occurring because of fluid retention. So this is occurring because of fluid retention or reduced glomerular filtration rate. If the glomerulus is not filtering blood and other substances effectively, meaning fluids will continue circling back to the body, and the body will have no choice but to deposit this excess fluid in other body compartments. And this is what results into the periorbital edema. So the next question is saying, with the aid of a well-labeled diagram, draw the nephron indicating at least 10 features. So the next question here is saying, So the next question here is saying, within the aid of a well-labeled diagram, draw the nephron indicating at least 10 features. So you need to draw a well-labeled diagram, something that should be interpreted as a nephron. And this should show at least 10 features. So when it comes to the nephron, okay, so when it comes to the nephron, this is how you can draw the diagram of the nephron. So this is how you can draw the diagram of the nephron. You need to show, structures showing the two blood vessels. So you have the efferent arterial. So you have the efferent arterial this side, and you have the afferent arterial that side, and you have the efferent arterial. So when blood is going to come in using this artery, and then it will leave the glomerulus using this artery. So whenever you are drawing such a structure, you need to show these two blood vessels. Apart from that, you need also to show the glomerulus. So inside here, you have the glomerulus, which is responsible for filtering of the blood that is coming in. So you have the glomerulus responsible for filtering the blood that is coming in. And then what covers the glomerulus is what we call the Bowman's capsule. So you have the Bowman's capsule covering the glomerulus. So you need to show those three structures. Apart from that, you need to show the proximal convoluted tube. So you have the proximal convoluted tube, which is just next to the Bowman's capsule. Then on the other side, you have the distal convoluted tube. So on the other side, you have this distal convoluted tube. Then when you come to this part, the middle part, so when it comes to the middle part, so on this middle part, you have descending loop of Henle, and you also have the ascending loop of Henle. So this is the descending loop of Henle, and you have the ascending loop of Henle. Then from there, you have the collecting duct. So you need to show at least 10 features. So you need to show the afferent arterial, the efferent arterial, the glomerulus, the Bowman's capsule, and that is four. You need to show the proximal convoluted tube. You need to show the distal convoluted tube. So that is six features now. Then you need to show the collecting duct. That is seven. You need to show the loop of Henle, ascending loop of Henle, and the descending loop of Henle. So you need to show all those structures. So from here, urine is now excreted. I mean, the contents are now excreted through urine or the ureter. So this goes to the ureter. And then it will be excreted through urination. So apart from knowing this structure, you also have to do what to know about how urine is formed. So apart from you knowing this structure, you need to know how urine is formed, because you may be asked to explain about urine formation in this same condition. So if you wanted another diagram, so you can also try to use this diagram if you're able to draw using this diagram, though it's a bit complicated. But if you're able to draw the inner part, the inner diagram, it will be the best to use. So if you're able to use this diagram, it will be easy to draw and label. This is the Bowman's capsule. You have the glomerulus inside. You have the efferent arterial and the afferent arterial. So blood comes in using the afferent arterial and leaves through the efferent arterial. Then you have a branch of arteries and the veins. Then this is the proximal convoluted tube, and you have the distal convoluted tube. This is the collecting duct. You have then here you have the descending loop of Henle, ascending loop of Henle, and you have the medulla loop, the medullary loop, which is more like where the loop of Henle makes an angle from where it turns from. So you can even use this structure if you're not comfortable with the other one. So you need to draw the structure of a nephron, which should be visible and be interpreted by the marker. The other question is saying, state 5 signs and symptoms that Mr. Hantovolo is likely to present with. So the other question is saying, state 5 signs and symptoms that Mr. Hantovolo is likely to present with. So when it comes to signs and symptoms, already we talked of proteinuria. So proteinuria, which is protein in urine, this is due to impaired glomerular filtration. So proteinuria is due to impaired glomerular filtration. The glomerulus is supposed to filter blood and also retain proteins, but because it is inflamed, it allows proteins to seep through and be seen in urine. Then the other symptom that may be present is periorbital edema. So periorbital edema is due to reduced glomerular filtration rate, or sometimes it could be due to fluid retention. So whatever reason you use will still be accepted. So in reduced, because the glomerulus is inflamed, meaning the rate at which it filters substances is also impaired. So there will be reduced glomerular filtration rate, meaning fluids and other substances will still be returned back into the body, and the body will deposit these excess fluids in other body compartments. That's why you are seeing edema. Then they may also be hypertension. So hypertension is due to reduced glomerular filtration rate. So the reason why hypertension comes in glomerular nephritis is because of reduced glomerular filtration rate. Remember, Paul has mentioned to say whenever an individual is suffering from a kidney problem, the heart or the cardiovascular system becomes also affected. So whenever there is a reduced glomerular filtration rate, renin, angiotensin are going to be released so that they increase sodium retention, which in turn increases hypertension or the blood pressure. Apart from that, they may also result into constriction of the blood vessels, which may result into increased blood pressure, because in the kidney there is reduced filtration and the body will respond by increasing the blood pressure, because filtration is all about blood coming at a high pressure. So blood coming at a high pressure from the afferent arterial and then leaving through the efferent arterial. So that's why there is also a symptom of hypertension. Then apart from that, there may be drowsiness. Drowsiness is due to accumulation of toxins in the blood. So drowsiness is due to accumulation of toxins in the blood. Dyspnea or difficulties in breathing is due to pulmonary congestion. So dyspnea is due to pulmonary congestion. So because the kidneys are not filtering the blood effectively, meaning a lot of fluids are going to be retained. Remember, even sodium will be retained and other things, meaning including other fluids are going to be retained inside the body. So there will be increased fluid volume in the body, which may result into pulmonary congestion and then cause dyspnea. Okay, so I've mentioned a lot of symptoms. Now, I think there are 5 of them. So other symptoms, you can read about them and also understand them, but you need the minimum of 5 symptoms, which are well stated for you to get the 15 marks. Then question D is saying, write briefly on hemodialysis. So the question D is saying write briefly on hemodialysis. So you don't need to write a lot of paragraph. It's just a few points that you need to write on hemodialysis. So when it comes to hemodialysis, this is just the process of purifying the blood of a person whose kidneys are not working normally. So in hemodialysis, you're going to use a dialysis machine to purify this blood. So there is hemodialysis and there's also peritoneal dialysis. The difference is that hemodialysis is extracorporeal. So hemodialysis is extracorporeal, meaning blood is filtered outside the body. But in peritoneal dialysis, this happens within the body itself. It's just a dialysate which will be infused in the body to promote filtration of the blood. So this type of dialysis is achieved, which achieves the extracorporeal removal of waste products such as creatinine and urea and free water from the blood when the kidneys are in a state of kidney failure. So your dialysis machine is going to remove waste products such as creatinine and urea. Urea, creatinine levels, remember when you're mentioning on investigations, you mentioned I will do blood for your urea and creatinine levels. So you are checking for these things to see if they are high, low, or anything. Then these waste products should be removed outside the body because if they accumulate in the body, they may cause toxicity and then injure the body tissue. So hemodialysis is one of the three renal replacement therapies. The other two are kidney transplant and peritoneal dialysis. So I have already talked about peritoneal dialysis, where you just infuse a dialysate in the human body to promote filtration of the blood. Then kidney transplant, so in a kidney failure or where there are no other options, where even the hemodialysis fails to work, the only option will be kidney transplant. You need to replace a kidney and find a donor. So an alternative method for extracorporeal separation of blood components such as plasma or cell is apheresis. Apart from that, the dialysis solution that is used may be a sterilized solution of minerals, urea and other waste products, potassium and phosphate diffuse into the dialysis solution. So urea and other waste products, which includes potassium and phosphate, they are going to diffuse or move into the dialysis solution. However, concentrations of sodium and chloride are similar to those of normal plasma to prevent loss. So there are other electrolytes that should be retained in the body, such as sodium and chloride. So their concentration in the dialysis machine are with the same concentration of as there in the blood, so that when the blood is moving in the dialysis machine, these electrolytes are not lost, but they are retained back in the body. So sodium bicarbonate is added in a higher concentration than plasma to correct blood acidity. And a small amount of glucose is also commonly used. So you can just briefly explain about dialysis by just explaining what dialysis is all about and giving those points to the examiner to get the full marks. So the reason why this question was brought here is because in management of a person with glomerulonephritis or any renal condition, you need to talk about dialysis because that will be the most effective management. So you need to talk about the dialysis. So sometimes you may be asked to write about peritoneal dialysis. So also read about peritoneal dialysis, because in peritoneal dialysis, you are infusing a certain substance into the peritoneum, the peritoneal cavities, and it promotes diffusion or filtration of the blood. Then the last question is saying, describe the nursing care that you would that would be rendered to Mr. Hantovolo during admission. So the last question is saying, describe the nursing care that would be rendered to Mr. Hantovolo during admission. So when it comes to the nursing care, meaning you are managing this patient with this condition, so just bear in mind to say renal conditions, it will be general nursing management, but of course you pay attention to maintaining normal fluid levels or if there's fluid excess. But in general, you just generally manage this patient. It's not like an emergency condition, it's not an infectious, but it will be general nursing management, unless if the cause of glomerulonephritis is being caused by a bacteria which can easily spread to others. But this is rarely seen. But management is general nursing management. So you can have your M's as usual, 4 M's, such as to correct fluid excess, because the common or the hallmark of renal condition, mostly they will result in fluid excess or sometimes fluid loss, depending on how that patient is affected. Then you can also mention to allay anxiety, to educate the patient about the condition, to prevent complication, to prevent acquisition of nosocomial infections. So you can have all those aims. You shouldn't worry much. Then from there, just the normal nursing management, which is from environment, you go all the way. This is because you won't have specific drugs to treat glomerulonephritis, unless if at all it is caused by infection. So if it is caused by infection, then you can start from medical management and mention antibiotics which can be prescribed. And the best antibiotics that can be given are penicillins. If at all the cause is maybe hypertension, it means you mention antihypertensive drugs. But if you have not been in your scenario, if in your scenario you have not been given a specific cause, like in our case here in this scenario, we have not been told what is causing this glomerulonephritis, meaning we are just going to generally manage this patient because we don't know what is causing this inflammation to the glomerulus. So it's just general nursing management, meaning you just mention your environment about nursing the patient in a medical ward, and then bring in other points. Also, the heading that you shouldn't forget is maintenance of normal fluid level. So maintenance of normal fluid level can come in after environment. This is general nursing management, but you're bringing in this heading to tell the examiner to say you are not going to ignore the edema or the accumulation of fluids in the body. Then, apart from that, you can also talk about observations. So this also goes in hand with, we talked of a symptom of dyspnea. So we talked of a symptom of dyspnea, which is difficulties in breathing. Difficulties in breathing will not always be present, and it may be a distant symptom. But when it comes to fluid, either fluid loss or fluid retention, this is what is commonly seen in renal problems. So that's why we are bringing in the heading to maintain normal fluid levels and like the heading for difficulties in breathing, where we can say maybe to maintain normal breathing pattern, because that is not commonly seen unless if it is present. But for fluids, almost present, it's either there's fluid loss or there's fluid accumulation in the body. So bring talk about fluids, talk about observations, position, you can talk about it. Maybe you elevate the foot end of the bed to promote circulation to major organs such as the brain, the heart, and other things, or nursing this patient in supine position. You can talk about psychological care. You need to explain this condition to the patient and tell them to say they will need probably dialysis, and explain how it works. Let them ask questions and everything that you need to talk about in psychological care. So here, hygiene, the patient may be bedridden. That's why you need to also to talk about hygiene. You can do hair care, nail care, mouth care, change of linen, soiled linen. You can offer a bed bath and other things. So a patient may be bedridden, so you can talk about hygiene. Then you can also bring in a heading for medication in this one. So if you didn't start with medical management, like in this case, which is just general nursing management, just bring in a heading for medication, because in a profenamide there is M, which means medication. So in medication, that's where you talk about the drugs that could be given to this patient, such as antibiotics, anti-hypertensive drugs. So you can talk about them in that heading. Then afterwards, you can talk about elimination, nutrition. You would have talked about it, exercises. So elimination should come in at last, but you can talk about nutrition, exercises. So it's just the general nursing management. There's nothing much that you can do for this patient or to offer special care to such a patient. So when it comes to complications of glomerulonephritis. So when it comes to complications of glomerulonephritis, there may be renal failure, where the renal system fails totally, either chronic or acute. So where the entire renal system fails, meaning a lot of glomerulus may have been affected, which may result in this failure. Then apart from that, the other complication may be convulsions, and this could be due to raised blood urea. Edema may be another, ascites. Ascites may be another complication if this is not controlled, the person may swell up on the entire body. Heart failure, and this may be due to circulatory overload. So you may have all those complications coming in glomerulonephritis. So you may see these complications coming in glomerulonephritis. So if we have any questions, we can ask, then we'll move on to our second question. Though this link will expire shortly, so I'll just reconnect and then you can click on the same link. Do we have any questions? If you have any questions, you can just type in the comment section and then I'll be able to see your questions. Okay. So you can just click on the same link to reconnect. This is almost 40 minutes, so that we do the last question, then we'll be done.